sense is like a sensibility, what we say, common sense, you know, thinking ability. That's the, I've just made a short form of it and I've called it sense and sensitivity. So do you all feel that these are things which are, you can see a lot of, or do you think there's a lack of this? Do you think these are needed? What are your thoughts on it?
It is necessary.
Yeah, of it course, is it is necessary.
There is a lack of it. Lack of it. There is a lack of it.
You find ourselves also and others also.
You find it in yourself also and in others also. What do you have to say? Yes? But you all are, all, some of you are senior citizens, and I've seen some of you in the temples and at in spiritual seminars. So when we are saying that we ourselves, you know, like I am a psychologist and I also have studied some spiritual disciplines like Vedanta. Like you rightly said, even I feel that, you know, these are both things which are very close to my heart, because I'm constantly working on trying to improve myself in these sense and sensitivity. So I'm saying is, how do you find that, you know, in spite of so much investment in your own personal growth, learning, that we are still lacking here?
Because habits die hard.
Habits die hard.
Yeah.
What else? Like, I mean, what is it? You know that we all have good intentions. We want to be sensible people. We want to be sensitive people. So what goes wrong? Where does it... And we are the so-called aware people. Like I see many of you come to the library routinely and you're reading, right?
Yeah.
So anybody who's reading, coming for any growth, you know, seminars, and if you're going to spiritual seminars, I mean, I underlying assumption is that you're interested in learning good things, being a better person.
Right.
So I'm saying people like us also, we are struggling with sense and sensitivity. So I don't know about the people out there who are not even aware of it. We can't even talk about them. You can't discuss it. I mean, I will portray a picture of the world today and all that, because those are the thoughts that I have formulated. I just want to get the interaction going as to what happens, why doesn't it work for us? Why doesn't it happen? What is the missing factor?
Missing factor doesn't convert into behavior. Actually, awareness is there sometimes.
Okay.
But when it comes to actual action or behavior, it is not translated fully.
Okay.
We are not practicing practical life.
So you are saying that awareness is there.
But implementation is not.
Yeah.
Yes, not practical.
But the behavior, awareness. But the behavior is what is missing, right?
Okay. Many times this happens.
Yeah.
After that incident, then we think that it's automatic.
Right. I think what you've said is very, very important and true, because this is what happens. We all know what is the right thing to do, but we stumble where the behavior is concerned. And one of the important sayings is that knowing is not doing. Doing is doing, which is the same thing what you are saying. That we may have the awareness, but unless it translates into our behavior or actions, we are not living that quality of life. It will always remain a gap between the ideal self that we have created for ourselves and the real person that we are. That gap will remain. To the extent that we can bridge the gap, we become a better person, and that ideal self does not remain ideal anymore. We become that person. And the reason the gap remains is because... What is a gap? I mean, how will you...
But we are not putting that much effort, okay? But slowly and surely, we are bridging the gap.
Okay. So I'm glad all these important words are coming from you all, you know. A very important thing, awareness you have developed also through effort, right? You have invested in knowledge by learning, listening, whatever else you're doing. You've created awareness. Now for awareness to transform into behavior again, you have to continue with effort. Everywhere, I mean, I'm saying our own lives are our learning ground. It's the laboratory. Every moment, this awareness is like a light. It has to be shining about your own self and your behavior. What am I doing? How am I conducting myself? What are my thoughts? What are my feelings? Once you have this light constantly on, at the end of the day, or depending on your awareness, it will give you like an audit. What did you do right? What did you wrong? And if you are still perseverant, then with your own efforts, you will find that more and more you are hitting on how you want to be. right? But very often, one thing is we are lacking in effort. The effort is poor. And sometimes, you know, our mind also, it mind deceives us, you know.
We become lax about
it. We want to, we always believe ourselves that we are good people. Like, you know, like I said, you know, okay, if we are going to a library, I'm going to the temple, I'm attending this, attending that. We create a version of ourselves, picture of ourselves, which may not necessarily be true. I mean, yes, these are the thoughts that I have about how I want to be. But am I there? If I'm not there, then I'm not that person. I only have those thoughts. Those are my fantasies. But our mind deceives us into, we identify with our thoughts and we believe that's what who we are. But unless you live that in your actions, you are not that. Okay, so that importance is very, this thing. And, okay, so we'll start with what is the, how is the world today? Let's have a look at the world today. All of us are seeing what's going on outside. What are we seeing? I mean, is it something to be happy about? Is it something to be sad about? What do you read in the papers? What are you seeing in the TV? What are you seeing in the news?
A lot of negativity.
Okay.
Chaos, confusion.
Negativity.
More anxiety.
Chaos. Confusion.
But there are some silver.
What else? One more word I heard.
Anxieties and illness.
Anxieties.
Confusion.
Yeah, I've written that. Anxieties. So these are the things which are increasing, right? All this is increasing. I mean, today we are talking about suicides and loneliness, depressions are increasing. Suicides, okay? Suicides. I'm saying because being from the mental health field, we are concerned about what is happening in the mental health also. Of course, all this is related to the mental health. We also, if you see physical health, you see lifestyle diseases are increasing. Our lifestyle is improving, but our quality of life is deteriorating. We are enjoying better lives, better facilities, better eating things, everything. But, so what is deteriorating? What is going down? Have we covered whatever is increasing in terms of negativity and everything?
Most of it are.
Prices are increasing, right? Prices. Corruption is also increasing. Then there is also the power, this thing. Abuse of power. Because we find that we are blaming BMC and the government and all that. So the abuse of power is increasing, yeah?
Lust, aggressiveness.
With suicides, it also includes depression and loneliness, huh?
Yeah. Indifferent attitude and indifference.
Yes, that's related to this. Indifference is related to that. I mean, we'll see there is a garbage lying on the road. We keep walking. We'll see somebody's injured. We keep walking because somewhere we don't know if we can deal. We don't know we have the resources internally and physically we don't have the resources to deal with external situations. This abuse of power is also increasing. Okay, these are all the things which are increasing. When we talk about decreasing, I find natural resources because prices of petrols are going up every time because we have totally exhausted by our own mismanagement are natural resources. You know, water, all these, all natural resources are decreasing. Even the internal human resources, internal means I'm talking about your mind power or your character, values, whatever you call it. Yeah, these are all decreasing. Yeah. Do you find this happening? You don't have to agree with me. Yeah? Anything else? What is decreasing? Mental health, I think we've already put it.
Do you see our sensitivity towards human beings?
Yeah, I mean the topic remains. So both sense and sensitivity are on the decline.
Increase in dishonesty.
That will come here. Dishonesty means the values, na? It hasn't come here.
Decrease in honesty.
Negativity will cover all that, I think. Okay. And even I was telling you, if we read the newspapers, when you're seeing TV, we are looking for something. Let's say we are always confronted with a lot of negativity. We need some relaxation, entertainment. You put on the TV. What do you see on the TV? I mean, if I have to entertain myself, I mean, if I put on the TV, frankly speaking, I will keep flipping channels. I don't find one worthy channel of seeing. I mean, what is the quality of programs today? What is Big Boss? It's a gossip house. I mean, they are being paid money to dramatize emotions, talk negative, fight, because that's entertainment for people. You know, that is what is the level. Today I'm saying, even when we see cinema, every movie box office hit hone ke liye item number hona zaruri hai. That's become the norm. You know, I mean, I was really shocked, like recently the mainstream cinema, you're having porn stars acting in mainstream cinema, family cinema. I said, now what is left, you know, if this is the state of the world that we are getting into. So I feel, and every day you're reading about people, businessman has committed suicide, he's jumped off the bridge, there is somebody who's got murdered, you know, woman, that Arushi's case, she was murdered, Raj Travels, the owner, he committed suicide, Asha Bhosle's daughter committed suicide, children in school are committing suicide. I mean, what is going on? You really wonder, and one really questions, what is happening?
So, attention.
Yes. Okay, so now let us look at, I mean, this is humans, these are animals, these are plants, and apart from plants, we also have the mineral or the vegetable kingdom. Yeah. Now, in terms of movement, in movement we find the mineral or the non-living things, you will not say that they have any movement. We are not talking about movement at a atomic and subatomic level. There is movement there. But externally, in non-living world, you don't see any movement. Okay, in plants you see movement because you see growth and you see movement. Animals, of course, you see a lot more movement because they can move. Not only plants are fixated in one place, they grow in one spot. They cannot move from one place to another. But in animals, we see that. And human beings, of course, not only in one place but all around, they can move in the skies and in the water also. Now, in terms of feelings, mineral kingdom, of course, has no feelings. Plant kingdom has. Sorry? Explain this. Okay, I'm talking about emotional feelings, yeah? Yeah, I'm talking about emotional feelings. I'm not talking about sensitivity, physical touch. I know touch me not plants and all are there. And some people also talk to their plants and they say that keeps them.
Can I cut you?
Yeah. And see, it is a thing because the universe is sustained by, is all, ultimately everything is energy. You know, when I'm talking about mineral kingdom also, when we are saying there is no movement, there is subatomic movement. Earth itself, right now we are stationary, but we are actually moving. The earth is moving. That's a different reality. So I'm saying, let us see a smaller reality for the time being. Okay, so plants, for that, don't have emotional feelings. They don't feel happy and sad. If you chop off the branch, they will not.
They cry.
Yeah, cry.
They
feel.
They feel.
They feel.
The feelings are rudimentary. Okay, so we, for practical purposes, I put a cross.
Okay, fine.
Rudimentary. Okay, animals, of course, you know, you do. I mean, you know, dogs, if you leave them, they get into depression, loneliness, all the other things. All the mad things that human beings feel, animals, especially the pet animals, will show all range of feelings. Okay, and human beings, of course, feel all, the whole entire range of emotions. Okay, and then now we have thinking. this does not have, this does not have, animals don't have, but human beings, animals, see, animals cannot think. If you see, if a lion sees like a, he's hungry and he has to hunt, he will attack and he will kill and he'll eat. He will not think about the young ones of the, he will not think his dear ke young ones ka kya hoga, should I kill or not. If after he has killed, he's not going to think, first let me feed my family. You know, first the always the male of the pride will eat and then the rest of the pride will eat. So animals also, thinking is not there, right? But the human beings, they have, you can see they are the only ones, the most evolved of the world. You have movement, of course, but feelings, because I have focused on sense and sensitivity. So thinking is related to your sense of reasoning, reason. We always say what distinguishes human being from animals is your capacity to think, okay, and also capacity to feel, because human beings have very powerful emotions. Animals will show emotions which are related to survival, fear they will show, and because we are evolved from the animals, we also have those basic emotions like fear, aggression, but we also have finer emotions. We have finer emotions which most animals are not capable of. I mean, you can put chimpanzees in training and do all that, teach them things, that is a different again thing, okay, but we are just taking a simple look at the way the world is. Now what happens is, what distinguishes us is this and this, sense and sensitivity, and we take it for granted that because we are human beings, we are sensitive and we are sensible. But as we discussed earlier itself, that most of us feel that we are still struggling with our both these faculties. Yeah? And I want to give you some like psychological research and all that, in which you will, I mean, you might have already read it, but for those of you who are not aware, you can go and further read up on it. Okay, there is a very interesting Dr. David Burns. Anybody has heard of him?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what is special about Dr. David Burns? Whatever, if you can give us a roundabout idea, I'll explain. Feeling related. Dr. David Burns, his book is called Feeling Good. Yeah. It's a mood therapy book, okay? In which the main important part is 10 distorted ways of thinking. This, I'm not going to discuss about what are the distortions, but if you read them, you'll find them very interesting. 10 distorted ways of thinking, how most of our thinking is far from how it should be. For whatever reasons, we've acquired these distortions as we grow up into adulthood, either because of our parenting, environment, whatever. And we are using that because, you know, thoughts is the framework that we use to function in the world, to contact the world. And all of you here wear glasses? Glasses? Chashma? Sun nahi hai, aise chashma pehnte ho aap? Pehnte ho na? Sab log ne pehna hai chashma? Haan, okay, so everybody has experienced what it is when you do not have normal vision, how the world looks to you, either nearsighted or farsighted. Yeah, you have experienced what the world looks to you. Without proper prescription and without proper glasses, you would be seeing a very hazy world, distorted world. Now what happens is, we are not even aware of all these psychological research. Most normal people are not even aware that we are carrying these distortions in our mind. So just as we on physical level without glasses will see the kind of world that we see, and we need glasses to see a proper world the way it is. So we need to correct thinking patterns by understanding what is thinking about. I mean, how many of us have sat down to understand the who am I as a person, what do I constitute of? Because we are learning about everything. Somebody is an engineer and somebody is a this thing. We are very well aware of the outside world. But we are failing miserably when it comes to our own selves. So this I'm not going into 10 distorted ways of thinking. I was just telling you is that thinking is not what it should be.
When I first read about that, I thought that sometimes I think in that black and white, all of the thing. I mean, when you read this book, then you come to understand.
Right.
I am not thinking aisa.
Right.
Till that time, you are not knowing that thinking is.
I mean, this makes you aware that many of the prejudices that we have in our thinking. You know, like what you're saying, all or none. We always think like, oh, so for some person, 2-3 times the person is late, or this person is always late. So that means we have already formed an assumption. We're labeling. Yeah, you can call it labeling also. All or none thinking, magnification. Those are few of the things.
Is it cognitive behavior therapy?
It's related to cognitive behavior therapy. Anything related with thinking is always cognitive behavior therapy, because you first identify what are irrational thoughts or what are distorted thoughts, and then you help them to correct it. Okay, so where were we coming to? Yeah, no, and another thing I wanted to tell you about thinking, one is this research that he shows. Then when we do training, professional training as counselors, a large part of our curriculum, besides studying psychological theories of different psychologists who have developed of personality and mind and all that, a lot of training that we are given is related to thinking and feelings. Like, how do you develop empathy? Because when we have clients who come to us for counseling, we need to learn these skills, that what are we supposed to do? Counseling session is not like a doctor is going to treat you with some stethoscope. He'll give you medicines, he will do some diagnostic techniques. But when we are as a counselor, we are going to sit with somebody, what we need is people skills. So these are related to people skills, both training in thinking and feelings. So we are taught all these things like empathy. You know, how will you make the person feel understood? How will you make the person be in his shoes and make him feel understood? Listening skills we take for granted. Arey, mere paas kaan hai, matlab main sun sakta hun. What is the big deal about it? But listening skills is another whole thing, you know, which needs, we are taught. We learn these things through role plays and through studies and based on research. So again, thinking is something that we are learning in professional counseling. What are the other ways in which you can develop your thinking? I think in my earlier talks, I have talked about body, mind and intellect, yeah? You must have heard these things. Body, mind, intellect, okay? Body is related to your actions, emotions, and this is related to your thinking. Body, mind, and this is the intellect. Intellect is your faculty to reason. How can you develop it? Like, you know, your physical muscles, when you want to develop it, you will exercise. You will eat proper food, you will exercise, whatever it is. Thank you. So suppose you have to develop your thinking muscle. Intellect is your faculty. Ki ye karne se mera thinking develop hoga. What is it that you can do? And I'm not talking about doing puzzles and all that. I know, firstly, we'll think of that. How to keep our mind active. I'm not talking about that.
Is there a difference between intellect and intelligence?
Yes. Intellect is a faculty. Okay? Intelligence is just a property. And intelligence, when we are talking, it's more information related. When you are aware of many things, you are intelligent. But intellect, when you are, I'm talking about, it is your faculty of discrimination.
Why you lose it?
Faculty of reasoning or discrimination. Even whether in schools or otherwise, you'll find there are some people who may be intelligent because they read a lot, they know everything. But there are some people you'll find that they may not know a lot in terms of information, but you find they're very sharp. When you say that person is very sharp, that's what you mean, that you know that person has an intellect. Matlab, he has his own thinking, which is not necessarily related to education that he's acquired or what the society is and everything. So there is something that he can think on his own. Okay, so my question to you all is, how do you develop this? We have discussed partly in the beginning when we were talking.
Diet also, that's sticking to diet.
Huh?
Diet
also helps, of course. See, when we are talking this, no, we are body, mind, intellect. And we don't know where one begins and the other ends. Right? Body kahan khatam hoti hai, then where does the prana start? Physiology we get into. Then when you get into, you know, the mind, where does the emotion start and where does the intellect start? It's easy to conceptualize and talk, but in terms of actual experience, we don't know how it is, you know. So when you're talking about exercising and nutrition, any level you put in a positive input, so not only it'll help that level, it'll help other levels also. Right? So if you are giving me an indirect answer, but that's not right also. If you exercise or if you eat properly, nutrition, your body will be healthy. Of course, it will help you emotionally also. Emotionally, you will feel more stable and calm. Because research has proved if you eat a lot of heavy food, you will feel very lethargy. Your mind gets disturbed. And also your thinking will be clear. If you are exercising, you know a lot of biochemical, these triggers and all. They say endorphins are released when you exercise. It's a feel-good hormone. When you eat properly, you can think clearly. That's why they recommend sattvic food. Eat light and nutritious food. Don't eat rajasic food. Don't eat tamasic food. So that is indirectly. You can come indirectly or directly. As long as you help me come here. How do you develop your thinking? What?
You have a healthy mind.
That is also true. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, so I'm saying, chalo, directly if you have to come here, how do you develop your thinking?
Exposing yourself to complex situations.
That's one way, yeah. Exposing your, I'm not writing it. Exposing yourself to complex situations.
Yes.
It's basically opening yourself to new experiences, right? Because whenever you are in a new experience, then again your mind is doing so many things, data collection, understanding environment, everything. It's a new environment, so your mind starts processing information and working. So that's one way to develop your intellect. What are the other ways?
You are in the state of being, okay? You are calm, okay? And you do not react, but you act. Then your intellect, you sharpen your intellect. Immediately you do not take an action. You respond to it. You don't react. So when you react, you don't do the right thing. When you respond, you think, and then you take action. For that you have to be calm, calculate, and then you take action.
What you are saying is responding and not reacting is, according to me, it is a consequence of having a clear, a good intellect. When you have a good intellect, you will think and you will talk. You will not impulsively just say something, right? So right now we are talking is, how do you develop your intellect?
The intellect development part will not depend upon the breathing pattern, upon the meditation pattern, upon the thinking pattern.
Breathing also can come here.
Responding to the environment pattern.
Medication, you said? Meditation.
Meditation.
Okay.
Then why is gone through them one already.
Okay.
No, but does the breathing and meditation
it
does.
You may introspect. No,
20%.
Breathing may improve your health and this thing, but I think
it
influence.
See, whatever all this is, all this will help you more at this level. Whatever the level input you are putting, it will help you maximum at that level. But it will also impact.
It may improve your brain capacity.
Breathing.
But intellect part.
Consume 30% of the oxygen. So regulated breathing is important for the development of our brain. And if that part is developed, this cognitive function thinking and all.
See, it is like the egg and the chicken situation.
Yeah,
because we said everything is interconnected. Both influence each other. Both are influencing each other. Your breathing will influence your thinking. And the fact that you will do pranayama, meditation, exercise or nutrition is because you have some capacity to think. Right? Only a person who knows that this will help me and improve me will do that. Which means where you got some of your basics right already. Okay. Anyway, what I was coming to is you can improve your intellect. We discussed this in the beginning. One thing is by investment in knowledge, which all of you are already doing. When you go for lectures from which you can learn, when you read books which you, from which you can learn, you're choosing stimuli and environments which are beneficial to you. So that definitely will help your intellectual growth. Okay. Choosing beneficial.
That will all help only.
Stimuli. I mean, ultimately, you're taking in this information, right? You're feeding yourself through your senses. So when you're taking in stimuli which are beneficial to you, because whatever we watch, whether it's in cinema, whatever we read in the books and everything, andar jaake sab processing hota hai, right? You see some of our... Just as in when we eat food, whatever we take, the body is very smart, you know, intelligent. It's already pre-programmed. It will take what's necessary. It will eliminate all the waste. So from our thinking and all that also, we are accumulating constantly so much information from the environment, whatever sense contacts we are making. But if we, from the beginning only, we are choosing beneficial stimuli, we are helping improve that function which is beyond our control. Internally, we don't know exactly what is going on, what is being kept, what is being thrown out. But if you are choosing this, so isme se bhi jo jyada beneficial hai wo rahega, others are getting eliminated.
I beg to differ. It's not a question of observer. It's a question of observer. I accept that the world is moving this way. Maybe it is not acceptable that some things are bad. But as long as I'm not judgmental,
right.
I'm not thinking that it's going to take this way.
Right.
I'm not a part of that movement. It is in spite of me, without me, there's no explanation to it.
Right.
So I have to develop that type of attitude.
What you're saying, I am with you. Being non-judgmental is the best. Being objective, being a witness. That is the ultimate and the best
that
way to be. But what happens, let's say, if suppose we are here today, okay? I'm not smoking. You are smoking. Okay? I'm not smoking, but I will suffer the harm of your smoke. It's an action that you are doing, but being in that environment affects me. It is going to affect me.
How am I going to respond to it?
However, I don't have to respond to it. Just being there is going to affect me in some way. Do you understand? Passive smoking is the example I'm giving to...
I accept it, but how am I going to respond to it? I accept that the person has a...
See, when you have no choice, when you have to go through situations in which we are not always going to get a proper life and picture and experiences the way we want it to be. Life will always throw you into situations where you have to go through experiences which may not always be what you want. Oh, this stimuli I don't want to take in. Let's say if you're walking down the road also, you'll see so many beggars or you will see filth, you will see this. And there are things sometimes you're genuinely helpless and can do nothing about. But you are taking in all that stimuli. Even on television, if you're watching something, some advertisements may come or so many things that you're beyond your control. Whatever is with your control and you can consciously choose, no, I think I want to watch National Geographic or I want to watch Travel and Living. I want to see what's in the news. I mean, depends on your mindset. because that is going to help you to develop your intellect. The more you are sure about that, I want to invest in the right things and not the wrong things. Because otherwise, when you keep letting yourself go, basically, one fine day you will find that, oh, this is the way it is. The world is functioning like this, I have also become part of it, you know. As against, no, this is what is going on, but I can still be my own person.
Each one has an identity. That identity I should not be second person. There are so many things happening around me, but I have an identity of myself.
Right.
And that identity I need to manage. If it's possible, I develop.
If you have maturity, objectivity, and you're clear about what you're doing, then you're good. Because ultimately, intellect, why we are developing is to develop your objectivity. When we were talking in the beginning about all the things which are the negativities on the rise and the positivities on the decline, it's because the whole idea of being sensible and being sensitive is declining. People are becoming less sensitive because society at large, we see, is not supporting sensitivity. It doesn't mean there's a lot of good things going on. A lot of arts, culture, all that is being promoted now. So it is not necessarily that sensitivity is on the decline. But by and large, if we see mostly the masses, then sensitivity is not seen as a positive trait. Because sensitive, I mean, we'll discuss that again. I mean, how much time do we have? Oh, we have half an hour. Okay. You can develop, I said, by choosing this thing. Then you're learning, you have to keep on practicing it. Okay. You have to keep on doing introspection. Somebody had used that word. Introspection. Self-study. I mean, if you want to be your own person, an independent thinker, where you think, you know, I mean, that the hallmark of being a human being is your capacity to think. And think doesn't mean having a herd mentality. Just because you have a brain and you have thoughts doesn't mean you're thinking. Thinking means, do you have a stand about everything that's going on around you? You may be a part of whatever is going on. It's nothing like, I'm not saying don't watch this or do this. No right and wrong. But do you have your own identity, what you were talking about in terms of your own thoughts? What do you feel about different things that are going on? Okay, so introspection, self-study, it gives you the overall picture of how you are vis-a-vis how the world is functioning. So you need to learn from different places, hopefully choose beneficial stimuli. You also need to introspect and self-study. And then, of course, there are some things which you can do as conscious actions. The other things are things which are beyond your control. Then it happens on its own. Right? Because I said there are so many things which are beyond our awareness. When we eat the food, we can control the quality of food that we are eating. But how the digestion is going to take place and all that is beyond us. So we can do these things to develop our intellect. Beyond this, what happens is on its own, one fine day, awareness, we drew that in the beginning. Awareness. And behavior. Anything that you find or notice about yourself that you want to work on, you will find that if you keep being aware about it, if you keep putting in the effort, one fine day you will find that it will transform into your behavior. It can. You will find it. Have you any examples to share on this?
You know, someone is crossing the road.
Yeah.
They didn't jump to obstruct that and pass away.
Right.
After that, you have a guilt thinking that, oh, I should have let those people pass away and coming in, getting blocked. This repeatedly happening, it finally changes that before that person is crossing, or even you're seeing it, you're able to stop before.
Right. Any examples you have about your own selves that you've struggled with something and then because you've been aware and constantly watching yourself on that, then you see that you are able to do that, you know. Any examples?
Jumping the queue.
Jumping the queue
where? For the ticket, for the bus, basically for the bus.
Okay.
You come in last and you see so many people standing, you come in last.
Right. I mean, see, the first thing, mentality comes, I don't know whether it's the survival instinct which is there in us or whatever, you know, we want to jump and be there.
Shortcut.
That is a human mind which is there in each of us. We have the tendency because we don't want to wait and all that. I mean, of course, we have to be smart and all that. We don't need to be totally lax and let the whole world go by and then we will do something. But yeah, that awareness, that window of awareness, if it is open, it definitely leads to a positive and the places to look out. Yeah, that all these are the small actions, but they are big time actually show where your awareness is. You know, in the bus queue or jumping a signal or when you're not crossing a railway track, you know. I mean, because the government, we are saying the government is getting corrupt and abusing power and all that. But the thing is, whatever is being provided to us, are we doing good to it? If we have these, you know, overhead bridges and all that, but mostly people don't, you know. We have these, called? Subways, no? But you see only the hawkers and the beggars have lined up there because they're pedestrians. Pedestrians are happy-go-lucky, they're walking in the middle of the road. I was just coming here and there was like a cow on the middle of the street. I said, this is what India, unless we see this, we don't feel we are in India. Yeah, exactly. So I think if we keep on working on this, keep on putting in the effort, it has to happen. But to the extent that, the laziness, all these are like, you know, the weeds. Whenever you're growing plants also, you have to constantly watch out for the weeds. Because if the weed is not taken care of, the plant will die out ultimately. The weed will suck in all the nutrition.
You have to
feed the plant, not the weed, you know. So I'm saying where our own self is also concerned, if we want our personality to really flower into the dignity of a human being, because I think both sensitivity and sensibility, these define the dignity of a human being, each of us. I mean, unless we have that capacity, I mean, there's nothing so good about us. You know, it's what is the difference between an animal and a human being? Another thing I think I have shared in an earlier talk, is that human beings are the only ones capable when we are, this is a human being, okay, I'm just drawing a stick figure. So we have, this is a head, so this is the intellect, this is the heart, which is the mind, and sexual organ is your body, okay. So the body, mind, intellect, we are in a vertical position plane, and a vertical plane is always like implying you can move towards evolution, whereas a plant is existing in a horizontal plane. Okay, so whatever, firstly, their thinking is very rudimentary. So their body, mind, intellect is all in this plane. It's like they are preordained, you know. It's like a fixed package. We don't know how they are constituted. But they are just full of a bundle of their nature, which they are exhausting. But human beings, we are on a different plane of consciousness. And we can grow in our consciousness. We can evolve. So I'm saying we are talking about evolving in another different dimensions. So if we have not even mastered the basic dimensions of sense and sensibility, which is what we consider as being what human is all about, then we can't talk about increasing our level of consciousness and going beyond that. Yeah. So why is sensitivity necessary?
Make this world a better place to live.
See, the people, when we are talking about statistics and people who feel lonely, depressed, commit suicide, okay, they are the people who have suffered and they are the people who are highly sensitive. Yeah, to a large extent, they're highly sensitive people. They're so sensitive that they cannot deal with the way the world is. So they feel, because I can't see the way the world is, better I make an exit. You know?
Deep depression,
of course. I'm talking about the extreme of suicide, but now the suicide no longer extreme. It's becoming so common. Like cancer, you know? Earlier, hardly we used to use her year of cancer. Cancer is becoming so rampant now. So we're talking about sensitivity. On one hand, the more sensitive a person is, the more you will feel things, right? Physically also you will find that if you are a more sensitive person, things affect you far more than somebody else. Anybody here would say you are a sensitive person physically or emotionally or?
After coming into meditation, I find that I become more of a witness and less of being too much sensitive.
But do you find you are a sensitive person?
Earlier,
do things?
Yeah, earlier I was sensitive, but in meditation, I find that it is better to witness what happening. Good things happen, don't get over excited. Bad things happen.
No, I'm asking general feedback from all of you. Do you find yourself as a sensitive person? I find myself as a very sensitive person.
We are all sensitive. All the question is to what extent?
Right.
Is that sensitivity is to such an extent that it is interpreting?
Means if somebody tells you something, does it really affect you? Like you'll say, oh my God, why did this person? You don't succumb to it, but you do get affected. The rest of you?
Who has said what is
there? You're giving too many who's and ifs and buts. Question, answer, simple, plain, yes and no. You're putting in too many this thing variables. Simple, it's not complicated.
Life is not a two axis. It is a multiple axis.
Right. But I am right now, I said it repeatedly, we are going to talk in a simple dimension.
Yeah.
Because we cannot bring in all the dimensions.
But
it becomes difficult.
We have become resilient. Only sensitive things happen. And the next day, we go about our work and nothing
else. Right. See, I have done work with schools and children, parents. And mostly what happens is a child who can deal with things, you know, his school environment, his home environment and all that is always applauded. Whereas children who get easily affected, you know, in the school, okay, the teacher told you something, gets affected. In the school, the had a fight with a friend in the school, the child gets affected. Or the parents scolded, the child gets affected. So these are the children who are highly sensitive, okay. Now, and this, there is this psychologist called Elaine Aron. She's written.
After sometimes they forget it.
Oh, that's what you think. That's what you think. You will be surprised. You will be surprised. People can carry emotional pain right through the deathbed. It's not as easy as that. No, you are talking about children. You're talking about a general view. Children may forget. There are things that you may fall, you forget, and then you carry on laughing. But there are certain things, especially emotional pain, and thing people have said things to them, especially close people, teachers, friends and all. That's what the whole counselings or sessions are all about. Because they bring the emotional pain, because that's what is hurting them, or even in their adulthood or even whatever age and stage in their life that they are. So she's written this book of the highly sensitive person, in which she has said that we are 15 to 20% people are highly sensitive. And she said their brains are also differently wired. I don't know whether she said it, but I definitely believe a highly sensitive person is far more intelligent. And you can, because your brains are differently wired, you are more aware, like, you know, what is the word? You're more aware of subtleties. This is what she said, okay?
What is the author's name?
Elaine Aron.
Yeah?
Elaine, E-L-A-I-N-E. A-R-O-N.
Aron.
Yeah. So they are aware of subtleties. They also get very overwhelmed easily. Because they can see and understand a lot more. Like I'm saying, let's say normal people are seeing a few dimensions. You're talking about multi-dimensions. A highly sensitive people can see many dimensions. So they, when they see one thing, it is, they're not seeing one thing, they're seeing 10 things. So they get easily overwhelmed because there's always an information overload which is coming to them. So their brain gets easily overstimulated, and because of which they get overwhelmed. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's what happens to them, and then they become high. That's what makes them highly sensitive. Okay? And I was telling you earlier, is in different cultures, sensitivity is valued very differently. So in countries or in societies where a lot of arts and all these phenomena taking place, you'll find these people are very comfortable. A very sensitive person will have, we have a lot of artistic side, you know, because they're very creative, thing is very strong of the highly, because you'll find most writers or people who are poets, people who are artists who draw, all these people are highly sensitive architects, you know, like people who are into the designing thing, because they feel a lot of pain. They can see a lot of things, you know, which maybe we can't see. I don't know what everybody's profession here is. But they use that high sensitivity and they create something out of it. So there are culture, and even within cultures, there are pockets which support this. But by and large, if we talk about the large society in general, it doesn't really value a highly sensitive person. If you are happy-go-lucky, if you nothing affects you, then you are more, you know, they say you should just take it in your stride. It's okay. But, so this is a... And
even atmosphere is not conducive for this.
Yes.
This.
So when I'm talking to you about the depressed people and all these, the ones who commit suicide and all that, I'm saying, see, we are also affected by the way the world is today. You know, we're not happy. Prices are rising. We don't know if we can afford the life that we are living. So everything is, to an extent, we are very stressed because everything overwhelming by, we are overwhelmed by the outside realities. But now what will happen? Are we going to go into depression? Are we going to commit suicide? Or we are going to say, this is the way it is and this is who I am and what is the best I can do in these circumstances. But a highly sensitive person, I'm not saying by large and rule. Maybe he can be very creative and pour out his troubles in that way. But some of the people, they get very overwhelmed. They see that it's a bleak picture and nothing will happen and they get into depression and many of them commit suicide. So they are sensitive. Because they are very sensitive, they suffer.
Okay. How do you place hyper students?
Children who are hyper? Are you asking if they are more sensitive and all that? They can be. Because they are also getting overstimulated. You know, so they are kind of jumping around and all that. And many things which children show are not necessarily what shouldn't be. But because for us as adults, it's easier that they not be hyper in a school because teacher needs classroom management. So for her, it's easier to have students who are obedient and sit in one place. In the home also, because we have so many things to do and children, they create more work. So we would rather not have them explore and all that. So we need to see where is it coming from. If it is coming from a child's, you know, natural curiosity, wanting to explore and understand his environment, if we are sensitive to that, then we should help and see. But generally, if you see it's just hyperactivity, where it's lack of concentration and the child cannot sit in one place, then you need to treat it with sometimes with medication, food control and behavior therapy. But I'm saying is everything requires a lot of thinking, a lot of patience. I'm saying what you're talking about, hyperactivity, can be something like this. The person is just overstimulated. Yeah. Okay, so I'm just trying to think of what else did I need to share with you.
You know, they are more intuitive also.
Yes.
Very sensitive.
Yeah, because they are more aware. So they are more aware of other people's emotions or where they're coming from. They are also, they get more affected also by how others treat them. I mean, I always say, like, you know, I find, like, or I always tell my friends, I feel I don't know if I'm suffering my own faults, because I think sometimes I suffer the faults of others, because for me it is a pain, like, you know, okay, how can this person be like this? You know what I'm saying? Sometimes you're very pained by the way people are in society, their insensitivity or whatever, you feel the pain of it. If you're a sensitive person, you feel, oh my God, like, because you feel that person has fallen so low that you feel that he's not living up to even the basic standard of a human being.
Like the person treating a sick patient, ultimately finds he gets all the negative ways towards him.
Yeah, right.
Apart from the sick patient.
I'm not even talking about counseling. I'm not saying that if as a counselor I'm dealing with somebody and I'm carrying his pain. I'm talking in terms of normal, general people. Like, let's say if we are sensitive and we see, like you are saying, when you jump a signal and you are aware of it. But I'm saying if you're on the other side of it, let's say you are a pedestrian and you see others doing it, also it would hurt you, you know. And when we read in the papers every day about how, especially in India, you know, like I feel there is no value to human lives. Because every day numbers are increasing, this one's dying, and then also people are happily sitting on the trains, crossing the tracks and doing all that as if it's like an everyday affair.
They never think.
Yeah. And sometimes I feel for most of us to remain sane, we have to keep that a little of like a horse with the blinker. No, if you are becoming too sensitive, then we maybe also get overwhelmed and we can do nothing about it. I mean, you can't.
It's not in our hands.
Yeah, exactly. You can't go and educate each and every person. We can just become more and more firm about the laws, you know. And there are many things which I think the government is already doing. But ultimately, even Marine Drive and all, these are so unsafe. Their cars are always speeding. And they have put those things where you can't even cross. But uske upar bhi people are coming and they're jumping on that. Means anything but, you know, like. I mean, that little lack of discipline, they don't mind if their life goes for a toss. You can be in a hospital bed for the rest of your life. Okay, any comments or questions? Like we discussed about how you can develop your thinking, how can you develop your emotions? Right. See, when we work with schools, we do some schools for children. They have, because nowadays people are to some extent understanding the need for counseling and awareness of emotions and all that. So there is life skills program. Okay. And emotional awareness means it is as basic, just as you learn your ABCs, you know, without which you cannot function for the rest of your life. And those are skills you are acquiring to be a literate person. But your emotions are a far more complex and subtle part of your personality. You also need, I mean, where our body is concerned, we have a basic awareness, right? We all have visited a doctor in our lives. Hopefully all of us have gone to a dentist and whatever the basic people who take care of your body. We all have visited those people. Now where your mind, which deals with emotions or your thinking is concerned, I'm sure it's very taboo in India to go to a counselor because counselors only treat mad people and we are not mad. We are not mad people. So emotional awareness is again learning the ABCs of your emotions. What are emotions? What are different emotions that you have? Yeah? You're talking about the emotions being appropriate and the extent of the emotion being appropriate to the situation, that comes later. You have to start with understanding, you know, because you have not gone through that. I don't know whether your schools had counselors and you learned these things. But there is never too late a time to learn.
We have to go to school again.
You can learn from your grandchildren and whoever is going to school. And if their school has a counselor, you can find out what they're doing because it really helps. I'm saying emotional awareness means knowing what are the different types of emotions we feel. Because very often, I'm saying, even in counseling or when we're talking to people, we find when you ask them how you are feeling, many of us socially are used to saying, I'm fine. Okay? Or you will jump into thinking, I think. But what are you feeling? Are you aware of your feelings most of the time? And not just saying, I'm feeling good or I'm feeling bad. Developing a feelings vocabulary. Whether you're feeling angry, are you feeling relaxed, are you feeling calm? If you go to any stationer, you'll find there's a feelings chart. So even if you're adult, I think there's no harm in looking at it. You use them on the mobiles, you see those emoticons, which are there, the faces. That's a new way of doing it, you know. Do you have on your mobile?
Yeah.
Yeah, so
But
see, all of them are not emotions, because some of them are eyelashes flashing like this and all that. All those are not emotions. But there's a feelings chart which talks about, let's say, when we say happy, happy is just one word, but the different, what you were saying, duration of the different, you can just be feeling little like joy, you can be feeling ecstatic. So there are different types.